Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents And Yet They Persisted, How American Women Won the Right to Vote, by Johanna Neuman. Narrated by Tanya Eby. Preface. The Mississippi Delta, sometimes called the most southern place on earth, resonates with the racial history of cotton, slavery, and the blues. In 1962, it became known for something more. Deep in Sunflower County, a 44-year-old African-American woman in ill health and with little education went to the county courthouse in Indianola to register to vote. For asserting this right, Fannie Lou Hamer, a poor sharecropper who made her living off the soil, was forced out of her home, fired from her job, menaced by drive-by shooters, and beaten by white jailers in a sexualized attack so severely that she was in pain for the rest of her life. Had she done little else with her life, Fannie Lou Hamer might have been little remembered today, a statistic of a life lived in hardship. But like generations of women before her and since, she rose up like a lion, demanding her right to vote. Her defiance fueled a grassroots movement in Mississippi in 1964. When young college students, moved by the persistent scourge of racism, risked their own lives to help those, like Hamer, who had been turned away at the courthouse door. Resistance from white segregationists was fierce. Both sides understood that the vote could unlock other reforms, that it was a tool of empowerment. Often, after dangerous encounters with the white male political establishment, she became the singing voice of her corner of the campaign, calming young activists with her rendition of This Little Light of Mine. Her testimony and her raw courage made her a memorable figure. When W.D. Marlowe, owner of the plantation where she worked as time and record manager for sharecroppers, first heard she'd gone to the courthouse, he said menacingly, "We're not ready for that in Mississippi now." To which Fannie Lou Hamer replied, "Mr. Marlowe, I didn't go down there to register for you. I went down to register for myself." For two centuries, American women of all races went down to register for themselves. From before the nation's founding in 1776 until the ratification of the 19th Amendment in 1920, they sought the vote, sometimes individually, often in groups, sometimes alone, often with men at their side. In the 1950s and 1960s, African American women fought again, battling Jim Crow laws in the South that barred Black Americans from quality education and public accommodations, and kept them from the ballot box. Obstacles in their path included literacy tests, poll taxes, and residency requirements, all meant to protect white supremacy. And later still, other women of color, Asian Americans, Hispanic Americans, and Native Americans, were empowered by new minority language ballots to participate fully in the promise of the nation's elections. Today, American women are still fighting to protect their votes. Then, as now, their motives differed. Some thought the vote would confer equal citizenship. Others hoped it would deliver the political muscle needed for their causes. From temperance to education, from abolitionism to civil rights, from social justice to pay equity. For all of them, the vote was their entry into public life. What made the journey so compelling, made the stakes so enormous, is that female activists were asking men to share political power. In the recorded history of politics, no concept is more enduring than power. And in the pursuit of power, no quality is more essential than self-interest. As Niccolo Machiavelli explained in his 1513 philosophical tract, The Prince, a wise ruler ought never to keep faith when by doing so it would be against his interests. That is why the revolution, with its rhetoric of no taxation without representation and its themes of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, did not liberate American women from the cords of patriarchy that had restricted them since ancient civilizations. It is why the Civil War, which outlawed the cruel institution of slavery, did not banish racism. And it is why the 19th Amendment, enacted in 1920 to guarantee women the right to vote, did not open all glass ceilings. Power guards its gates zealously, and no gates once locked open easily. Because those in power never offer concessions to those without power unless they perceive that it would benefit them politically, female activists set out by the early 20th century to convince men that the advent of women voting, or at least some women voting, would be in their interests. They organized one of the broadest class coalitions in history, a mass movement that before it finished in 1920 attracted working class and elite women, professionals and educators, actresses and librarians, housewives and factory workers. In building this mass movement, in appealing to both male and, in the West, beginning in the 1890s, female voters, suffrage leaders assured those in power that enfranchising women would not change the electorate's racial composition. Playing the white race card, as Elizabeth Cady Stanton and Susan B. Anthony had done decades before, both moderates and militants in the 20th century movement limited their cause to expanding the voting population, not committing it to social change. They invited speakers from Colorado, which enfranchised women in 1893, to lecture on how little had changed in the state's voting profile since. In public advertising campaigns and private buttonholing of legislators, they made clear they were fighting not for universal suffrage, but for educated suffrage, code for white entitlement. In their parades and their picketing of the White House, they rarely invited women of color to share the stage. The image, like the message, was Anglo-Saxon. It might seem as if the right to vote is one of those inalienable rights promised to every citizen by the Declaration of Independence, but the U.S. Constitution does not describe voting as a right of citizenship. In fact, the original document, enacted at the Constitutional Convention of 1787, made no mention at all of voting by the public. In a compromise crafted by the Founding Fathers as the price of uniting the colonies into a republic, the nation's foundational document left it to the states to develop their own qualifications for voting. At first, most states extended the vote only to white property owners, often also requiring a period of residency to prove fidelity to the state's interests. During the 19th century, some states extended the franchise to foreigners or to women, in hopes this offer of privilege would encourage more migration to their sparsely populated communities. To readers interested in political reform, this long history of the Votes for Women campaign offers some lessons about the power of grassroots activism and some cautionary tales about the speed of social change in the face of patriarchy, racism, and sexism, all weapons in the fight to maintain power. And to those seeking to add women back into history or to put human faces to political events, it offers the narrative virtues of a group biography. One mission of this book is to reinsert the story of women's struggle for equal rights into the meta-narrative of U.S. history. For too long, the cause has been studied as a separate story, untethered to its times. Suffrage leaders may have thought they could set sail alone, and often they tried. In fact, their course was greatly swayed by other events in U.S. history, from the Revolution to the Civil War, from World War I to the Civil Rights Movement. Most historians begin the story in 1848, at a women's rights convention in Seneca Falls, New York, when Elizabeth Cady Stanton first stood in public and demanded the right to vote, and end it in 1920, when Tennessee became the 36th state to ratify the 19th Amendment. This book seeks to extend the boundaries of that history, positioning its origins with the revolutionary fervor in the 1770s, and its final triumph 2 centuries later, when the Justice Department won new tools to enforce the country's constitutional amendments. In widening the lens, it becomes clear that men would not voluntarily surrender power until women were powerful enough to demand it. At every marker of change, from the movement to give women the right to vote in school board elections in the 1880s, to debates about whether to enfranchise illegal immigrants in the 2010s, politicians saw it in their interests to diffuse demands for social change by opening the tent ever so slightly to those on the outside. The other mindful contribution of this narrative is to return women of color to its telling. Black women have always treated the vote as a sacred trust, understanding its power to transform lives and, as suffragist Josephine St. Pierre Ruffin put it, to lift as we climb. that white suffrage leaders shunned involvement of Asian Americans, African Americans, Hispanic Americans, and Native Americans in an effort to curry white male support has been much documented. The contributions and persistence of the suffragists of color in the face of abject discrimination is among the subplots that gives this story its poignancy. Beyond broadening the movement's timeline, rejoining it to the arc of its times, and reinserting women too long silenced, this project seeks to equip readers about the tools to make their own history, in the shadows of this one. As voters and lawmakers now wrestle with issues such as the disenfranchising nature of gerrymandering, immigrant voting, and the drive to restore voting rights to felons, the nation's evolution from dedication to the common good to protection of individual rights here claims a place on the shelves. Before we begin the story, a few words of explanation about language. Most American activists who participated in the movement shunned the words suffragette, which had been applied to British activists. British journalist Charles Hands first coined the term in 1906 to mock female agitators who used militant tactics, arson, bombs, and destruction of public property, to draw attention to the cause. He meant to belittle the ets as less serious and respectable than the constitutional suffragists. Mainstream leaders such as Millicent Fawcett, head of the National Union of Women's Suffrage Societies, relied on lobbying and public parades. Emmeline Pankhurst and members of her women's social and political union, who initiated militancy, embraced the suffragette slur as a badge of honor. To American suffrage leaders, association with British movement violence was not calculated to win favor with the very male voters whose support they coveted. They called themselves suffragists, which had the further advantage of being a gender-neutral term, and I have honored their choice by referring to them in that way as well. Likewise, the term feminist was rarely used before the 20th century, so I have avoided it as much as possible. As to the term suffrage, it derives from the Latin word suffragium and the old French word suffrage, and originally referred to prayers or pleas on behalf of others. Its modern definition as the right to vote evolved in the United States. A few words are in order, too, about organizational titles. In the 19th century, at the birth of many reform causes, it was the common expression to seek a woman's right to vote rather than women's right to vote. That is why groups seeking rights for women are often styled in the singular, as in National American Woman's Suffrage Association, NASA. I have preserved that preference. Likewise, for African American advocates in the late 19th and early 20th centuries, it was accepted style to use the word colored in titles. Examples include the National Association of Colored Women, NACW, and the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, NAACP. Those titles are used here not to offend modern sensibilities, but to honor history. Finally, wherever possible, I have avoided the formulation that men granted women suffrage. As you will see, there was nothing passive in the effort by American women to fight for their right to the ballot. For two centuries, in petitions and parades, with warring tactics and diverse motives, they fought for access to the ballot. It was the women who launched petitions in the 1830s, attended suffrage conventions in the 1850s, and strategized to win victories in the states in the 1870s and beyond. It was the women who studied politics and embraced tactical innovations that finally convinced Congress in 1919 and then the states in 1920 to enfranchise women. Both white and black activists gained suffrage by redefining male political self-interest. Expediency is the lingua franca, the common language of politics. Male lawmakers voted for women's suffrage only after women were powerful enough politically to challenge the male hegemony. That was why the early victories of Wyoming, Colorado, Utah, Nevada, Washington, and California from 1890 to 1911 were so telling. By 1912, 1.2 million American women could vote for president. By 1918, Woodrow Wilson, a Southerner and longtime opponent of women's suffrage, joined their cause. His stated public reason was that women had aided the win in World War I and deserved the vote as their reward. "We have made partners of the women in this war," he reminded a foot-dragging Senate. "Shall we admit them only to a partnership of suffering and sacrifice and toil, and not to a partnership of privilege and right?" His private motive was more prosaic. He understood that without their votes, he would not have been reelected, that without female votes, no president would ever win again. Political capital, like financial capital, atrophies if it lies dormant, shriveling from the missed opportunities of leveraging power. For 2 centuries, 8 generations of American women learned to harness their aspirations to the self-interests of men with power. It was never a linear path, more often a history strewn with obstacles. And this demonstration of tenacity and grit began, as most things American, in the Revolutionary War. About the companion website. This book is accompanied by a companion website, www.wiley.com/go/Neuman. The website includes the following supplementary materials: primary sources, questions for discussion, for further reading. 1. The Dawn of Republican Motherhood. Lydia Chapin Taft no doubt wore black on October 30, 1756, when she attended a town meeting in Uxbridge, Massachusetts. Both her 18-year-old son Caleb and her husband Josiah had died the previous month. During their 25-year marriage, Josiah had worked his way through the ranks of the esteemed, becoming a captain in the militia, serving on the local board of selectmen, often chosen to represent their town in the Massachusetts General Court. His astute purchases and sales of property made him a wealthy landowner and left Lydia, with 3 minor children still at home, the town's largest taxpayer. Property assured male patriarchy and conferred status on landed families. So civic leaders in Uxbridge, not far from the Quaker stronghold of Worcester, where women were invited to speak at meeting, asked Lydia to cast a vote in her husband's place. Her affirmative vote on funding the local militia was the first of 3 she would cast as a widow. 2 years later, in 1758, she voted on tax issues. And in 1765, she again appeared at a town meeting, this time to weigh in on school districts. Before Massachusetts or the other original 13 colonies declared their independence from the British, she became America's first recorded female voter. Central to scholars of women's history is why the American Revolution, with its rhetoric of no taxation without representation and its themes of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, did not liberate American women. After the war, revolutionary leaders encouraged women to act as keepers of civic virtue, teaching young Americans the perils of monarchies, instilling a quality of democracy in the next generation of patriots. Historian Linda K. Kerber, who coined the phrase the Republican motherhood, noted that this new function restricted women to the domestic arena, while giving them new standing in the polity. Others have countered that this post-revolutionary era saw more of a turn toward a Republican womanhood, tethered less to a woman's role as a mother than to her place as a citizen in the new republic, with influence not only on children, but also on suitors, husbands, and brothers. By whatever name, the emphasis on women's role in America's new democracy unleashed a surge of interest in female education and public participation. That is why it is important to begin this account of women's suffrage not in the 1840s, when women's rights activists began to call conventions, but in the 1790s. When they began to participate in the nation's political life. It was here, early in the Republic's history, that women joined the public sphere, learning to stand and speak. This controversial first step toward activism would have lasting effects on the right for the vote over the next 2 centuries. Antecedents of Republican Motherhood. Like other linguistic constructs of history, patriarchy was a concept designed by men to favor men. In biblical story, Eve lured Adam to sin, casting both of them from the Garden of Eden. In ancient Greece, Aristotle excluded women from the polis, which he regarded as the highest calling in life, arguing that those who did not participate in the political life of the state were little better than idiots. The main function of wives in ancient Greece was to produce male heirs. Girl infants could be killed at their father's discretion. Part of the patriarchal code required dividing the female population into respectable and non-respectable women, rewarding women who showed their obedience to men through sexual subordination, allowing men to roam the sexual field with slaves, lower-class women, or young men. Men would fight wars, oversee property, participate in the nation's public life, and dictate the rules for women and children at home. Women would obey or find themselves further degraded as prostitutes or impoverished servants. By the time of British kings, men had devised a new construct of power. The concept of coverture was embedded into common law, ensuring that a woman, on marriage, would cede all legal rights to her husband. She had no right to own property or keep income, no parental rights over her children, no standing in the law to make contracts or petition for divorce. Though they flew the British flag, the colonies survived in a land of natives, immigrants, and territorial ambition. Soon, some laws of patriarchy loosened. Wives of German and Dutch immigrants, not bound by English laws, had more control over their own property and could write wills. Once talk of rebellion began, with its rhetoric of unhappy families and tyrannical rulers, colonies such as Massachusetts and Connecticut liberalized divorce laws, allowing women to divorce on grounds of adultery, bigamy, or impotence. And by the 1750s, opportunities for both girls and boys to obtain a formal education increased as academies in New York and Philadelphia advertised in newspapers. In 1792, amid the French Revolution, English author and philosopher Mary Wollstonecraft further stoked the debate over education by publishing a tract, A Vindication of the Rights of Woman, pondering the injustices of male privileges and the meaning of women's rights. If women were assumed to have natural rights conferred by God, then it was up to the state to validate them, she argued. The book, which sparked debate on both sides of the Atlantic, contested the male view of women as superficial. If women lacked the language of politics, she argued, it was only for lack of adequate education. Dismissing the idea of teaching women ladylike demeanor, she advocated co-educational institutions where women would be schooled for their minds, not their manners. "I do not want them to have power over men, but over themselves," she wrote. "Their first duty is to themselves as rational creatures." With the sure knowledge that her idea might excite laughter among men, she also suggested women ought to have representatives instead of being arbitrarily governed without having any direct share allowed them in the deliberations of government. The title of Wollstonecraft's book paid homage to the Manifesto of the French Revolution, the Declaration of the Rights of Man and of the Citizen. But even before its publication, men and women in the colonies had pondered the roles of male and female citizens in a new republic. After the Revolution, American women would instill civic virtue in the next generation, while men attended to the dirtier call of politics. This gendering of America, much like the effort by Europeans to impose gender-based divisions of labor on native peoples, reassured men such as John Adams that power always follows property. But on some level, Republican motherhood was thus the price patriarchy paid for its survival. It was also the vehicle women would use to wrest new rights from a stubborn male polity. Winning the War and the Peace. Before the 1760s, many women were limited by their obligations in the home. The work was difficult and exhausting, described as backbreaking duties in the fields, repeated childbirths, taxing meal preparation, and daily and day-long efforts to keep dust and dirt from invading primitive homes. Indentured servants, black and white, suffered from broken bones and pulled muscles from lugging 20-gallon containers of water from well to home for bathing and cooking. For the African Americans who were enslaved, one-fifth of the nation, duties were exhausting, tinged with the threat of whippings and separation from loved ones on the auction block. Women who expressed interest in politics were rare, as it was considered unnatural. Exceptions were made for some upper-class women, such as Mercy Otis Warren, who during the war years published plays and poems under the pseudonym A Columbian Patriot. But once appeals for resistance spread through the colonies, women for the first time joined debates, wrote missives, and asked their husbands to send them updates on military developments. "Nothing else is talked of," Sarah Franklin wrote to her father Benjamin Franklin. "The Dutch talk of the stomp tack, the Negroes of the tamp, in short, everyone has something to say." Traveling from Cambridge to Boston, one writer reported seeing, "at every house, women and children making cartridges, running bullets, making wallets, baking biscuit, crying and bemoaning, and at the same time animating their husbands and sons to fight for their liberties, though not knowing whether they should ever see them again." As her husband John Adams set off for the Second Continental Congress in Philadelphia in 1776, Abigail Adams wrote him a letter. Hungry for details of the war effort, she begged him to write often, with details on what sort of defense Virginia can make against our common enemy, whether it is so situated as to make an able defense. In joining a governing body that would lead the 13 colonies during the Revolution, she urged him to remember the ladies, warning that women would foment a rebellion if attention is not paid to their interests, that they would not hold ourselves bound by any laws in which we have no voice or representation. She was not the first woman to seek a voice in politics. In 1648, Margaret Brent, an unmarried property owner, went before the Maryland Assembly requesting a vote and a voice for herself and for Cecil Calvert, Lord Baltimore, as she held his power of attorney. The governor of Maryland denied both requests. In 1733, a few property-owning women wrote the New York Journal protesting their disenfranchisement. There is no record of a response. Half a century later, as the colonies were on the cusp of revolution, there came a male rejoinder. It was filled with contempt and disdain. "To your extraordinary code of laws, I cannot but laugh," John Adams replied to his wife's warning of a female rebellion. "Depend upon it, we know better than to repeal our masculine systems." Soon after, James Sullivan, a member of the Massachusetts General Court and a colleague, likewise wrote John Adams, suggesting that the vote be extended to disenfranchised citizens, such as women and men without property. One of the Revolution's legacies had been a loss of deference, where shoemakers stood next to their elite customers as both threw tea into the Boston Harbor. Sullivan's plea for universal suffrage was part of this new egalitarianism. The reply from John Adams was less flippant than that he offered his wife, but no less dismissive, reflecting his elitist views. Warning against altering voter qualifications, Adams predicted, "There will be no end of it. New claims will arise. Women will demand a vote. Lads from 12 to 21 will think their rights not enough attended to. And every man who is not a farthing, 1/4 of a penny in British coin, will demand an equal voice with any other in all acts of state. It tends to confound and destroy all distinctions and prostrate all ranks to one common level." Adams believed that granting a vote to citizens without a permanent stake in the community, without property, without residency, was dangerous, much as Greek philosopher Aristotle had suggested centuries before. But Adams also understood the implications of revolutionary rhetoric, the logical extension of its arguments. His comment, "There will be no end of it," was prescient. More than any other revolutionary leader, he feared and may have foreseen the waves of changes in the country's electorate as succeeding classes of residents gained access to the ballot. For now, he and other founding fathers were busy leading a rebellion against the status quo. And in one of the revolution's unintended consequences, women heard its call. Once shielded from politics, occupied with backbreaking duties in the domestic sphere, they became its great champions. All over the colonies, effective boycotts against British products had required a buy-in from women. And buy-in they did. Women founded anti-tea leagues, meeting to brew concoctions of raspberry, sage, and birch to substitute their herbal mixes for well-regarded English teas. Wives and daughters engaged in public-spirited measures, growing their own food, and weaving their own clothes. Called Daughters of Liberty, women would convene at the home of a local minister, sharing camaraderie as well as material, with as many as 100 weavers. Hundreds of spectators came to watch. Young women especially resonated to the task, feeling they were making a contribution to the nation's future. One girl who participated in spinning parties wrote that she felt nationally part of a fighting army of Amazons, armed with spinning wheels. Calling the phenomenon a display of female patriotism, an editor at the Boston Evening Post wrote, "The industry and frugality of American ladies must exalt their character in the eyes of the world and serve to show how greatly they are contributing to bringing about the political salvation of a whole continent." Not all observers were so enamored. Both before and after the war, some newspapers complained that American women had undercut the boycott by their excessive spending on British imports. This was perhaps an assertion made by men who feared crediting any female contribution might lead to their emancipation. Accustomed to the insults, some women said they expected little from their participation. "You know that our sex are doomed to be obedient in every stage of life," wrote Mary Stevens Livingston, whose husband Robert was named by George Washington, as one of the Committee of Five that drafted the Declaration of Independence. The others were Thomas Jefferson, Benjamin Franklin, John Adams, and Roger Sherman. So we shan't be great gainers by this revolutionary contest. But there is little question that the boycotts politicized the household economy and the domestic conversation. As John Adams put it, was not every fireside indeed a theater of politics? Revolutionary excitement was evident throughout the colonies. Eliza Wilkinson, living in South Carolina's Sea Islands, said that by the time the British Army invaded her state in 1780, no greater politicos existed than the several knots of ladies who met together, looking for all the world like perfect statesmen. After Charleston fell to the British on May 12, morale plummeted in the Continental Army. Poorly fed and rarely paid, they became the very definition of a ragtag army. Local officials and merchants in Philadelphia solicited funds to pay them. Women signed up for public-spirited measures, such as cleaning. And Esther DeBert Reed, wife of the governor of Pennsylvania, took to the newspaper to plead for female patriots to do more. In Sentiments of American Woman, she urged women in Philadelphia to form an organization to raise funds for the American rebel troops. "Animated by the purest patriotism," she wrote, "the time is arrived to display the same sentiments which animated us at the beginning of the revolution, when we renounced the use of teas, however agreeable to our taste, rather than receive them from our persecutors." With Sarah Franklin Bosch, she organized a ladies' association, much imitated throughout the colonies. The Philadelphia chapter raised enough money from Quaker homes and alehouses alike to give each soldier $2, which Reed advocated. Fearing soldiers would use the money for alcohol, General Washington vetoed the idea, insisting the money be spent to sew shirts for them. Patriarchal to the women as well as his troops, Washington kept both in line. Commentators may have snickered at General Washington's sewing circle, but the general ceded no ground. In the end, the Ladies Association of Philadelphia sent 2,220 shirts to the beleaguered Continental Army, while the New Jersey chapter sent 380 pairs of socks. Other female patriots, less affluent, showed their support by cooking and cleaning for the troops, often seeking food in return. In an affidavit she filed to demonstrate her entitlement to a pension, Sarah Osborne testified that during the war she did washing, mending, and cooking for the soldiers. Once, while she was carrying provisions, she ran into General George Washington, who was exasperated by the presence of the so-called camp followers, once describing them as a clog upon every movement. He asked Osborne if she were not afraid of the cannonballs. She replied that she was not. "The bullets would not cheat the gallows," she said. "It would not do for the men to fight and starve, too." Beyond demonstrating their patriotism in these gendered, acceptably feminine endeavors, other women, if only a few, actually engaged the enemy. Mary Hayes McCauley was a camp follower who carried water to the troops, often under fire from British troops. When her husband William Hayes was carried off field at the Battle of Monmouth in New Jersey in 1778, she kept his cannon loaded. Said to be the inspiration for the legendary Molly Pitcher, Mary later received a pension for services rendered in the Revolutionary War from the state of Pennsylvania. More directly, Deborah Sampson took up arms and men's clothing. Enlisting as Robert Shurtleff in the 4th Massachusetts Regiment, she served for 18 months in 1782 to 1783. Wounded twice, she was discharged after the second injury disclosed her gender. Kate, a slave on Stephen Hurd's plantation in Georgia, infiltrated a British war camp at Fort Cornwallis, where Hurd was being held. After a few days of earning the trust of British guards by doing their laundry, she advised them she wanted to give the prisoner clean clothes. Admitted to his cell, the 6-foot-tall Kate picked up Hurd, a small man, and placed him inside her basket, leaving the prison with the basket on her head. Arriving in Augusta, where she had hidden two of his Arabian horses, the two rode off. It is said that Hurd offered Kate her freedom. Of pure African descent, claiming to be the daughter of a powerful king, she declined, perhaps understanding that she would always be rewarded for her loyalty as she and her husband Jack, a gardener, continued to work for the Hurd family until their deaths. As Britain had offered to free any slaves who joined the cause, black slave women often sought rescue from the redcoats. In the South, an estimated 55,000 slaves escaped during the Revolution, 1/3 of them women. After the British captured the estate of Mary Willing Byrd in Virginia, 49 of her slaves went with them. In later years of the war, as the British military sailed for home from Savannah and Charleston, an estimated 10,000 slaves from each port, male and female, accompanied them. Others resonated to the themes of the American cause. Phyllis Wheatley, taught to read and write by the daughter of her white enslaver, was the first African-American woman to author a book of poems. Her Poems on Various Subjects, Religious and Moral, was published in London in 1773. Later, she wrote odes to George Washington and Benjamin Franklin. In a letter to her on February 28, 1776, Washington called her style and manner striking proof of your great poetical talents. During the war, he asked Wheatley to visit with him at his military headquarters, and shortly after the visit, he ordered that blacks be conscripted into the Continental Army. An estimated 5,000 black men, some slaves offered false promises of freedom by their owners for fighting, served under Washington in the Revolutionary War. Still other African-American women used abolitionist sentiment in the North to seek freedom. Trapped in slavery, they found their voices in defying the cruelty of human bondage. In 1716, Joan Jackson became the first enslaved woman to win her freedom through courts in New England, although she was unable to free her children. In 1780, slave Mum Bett was present in her town square for a reading of the newly ratified Massachusetts Constitution. On hearing the document's first article, "All men are born free and equal and have certain natural, essential, and unalienable rights," she determined to fight for her freedom. She and another slave hired abolitionist lawyer Theodore Sedgwick and won their case in court. The County Court of Common Pleas in Great Barrington found that the phrase, "All men are born free and equal," meant that there could be no such thing as perpetual servitude of a rational creature. A slave for 30 years, Mum Bett changed her name to Elizabeth Freeman, serving as governess to the children of the lawyer who had represented her in court. And in 1796, while serving as president from the nation's capital of Philadelphia, George Washington sat down to dinner as one of his wife's favorite slaves. 23-year-old Oney Maria Judge fled from the house. With help from the city's population of free blacks, she was walked or likely spirited through the streets of Philadelphia, boarding a ship to New Hampshire. Soon, she married a free black sailor named John Staines, bore 3 children, and spent the rest of her 75 years looking over her shoulder, living the life of the hunted. In 1796, George and Martha Washington, leaving for a summer trip to Mount Vernon between sessions of Congress, launched an intense campaign to recapture Ona Judge, offering a reward of $10 to any person, black or white, who would bring her home. Slavery and patriarchy, racism and sexism, all had survived the revolution. Men had welcomed the patriotism and sacrifices offered by colonial women, shaming those who had failed to do their share. They had accepted, if grudgingly, the patriotism of black soldiers, a military necessity after the British offered to free any African Americans who fought on the Loyalist side. But as Adams made clear, even amid the fervor of revolutionary rhetoric that championed egalitarian principles, men had no intention of repealing our masculine systems. Even in New Jersey, which in its constitution offered the vote to both women and free African Americans who were property owners, the same requirement for male voters, the privilege was designed to limit numbers of these newly enfranchised voters and ensure that white male dominance, indeed that the political status quo, was preserved. The New Jersey Exception. Like Massachusetts, New Jersey also wrote an early foundational document ratifying its constitution on July 2, 1776. In the document, the new constitution offered the ballot to all inhabitants of this colony of full age who are worth £50. No records remain about legislative debate over this radical idea, and some have wondered if this provision was accidental, a deliberate attempt to empower women and blacks who owned property, or a mere oversight. The state constitution included other reforms popular among colonists, such as a bicameral legislature, that suggest the suffrage provision, which applied to free blacks as well as women, was intentional. Others have wondered if New Jersey's Quakers, who welcomed female speakers, may have been the impetus for this extension of the vote. Either way, the new vote for women applied to only a small proportion of the population. Coverture laws meant women could not own property unless they were single, femme sole, or widowed, like Lydia Taft. Married women, femme covert, gave up rights to own property, which transferred to their husbands. No one knows how many single or widowed women of 21 years or older in New Jersey had amassed £50 worth in holdings by 1776. Pamphleteer William Griffith, who said he found it perfectly disgusting to watch women cast ballots, thought the number considerable, saying, of widows and spinsters above 21, there cannot, I imagine, be fewer than 10,000. Others put the figure at 20,000. Whenever new parties vied for power in the state, Patriots in 1776, Federalists in 1789, Republicans in 1797, men reached out to female voters to expand their base. Women attended public rallies, lobbied for patronage jobs for their male relatives and family friends, raised money for political causes, actively campaigned for candidates, and were invited to celebrations of George Washington's birthday. Politicians on all sides sought to endear themselves to these new voters, offering carriages to transport them to the polls. But the guiding rule of suffrage history is that male politicians never cede power unless it advantages them. Griffith and other men in New Jersey always saw female voters as disorderly, accidental members of the polity. By the 1790s, after the French Revolution turned violent, its cries of liberté, égalité, fraternité, fading with the guillotining of the king and queen, politics in America grew more divisive. Washington and Alexander Hamilton saw the revolution's terror as a warning about the dangers of unbridled democracy. Jefferson and James Madison believed the excesses would right themselves, that France would become a republic. Gone were the warm feelings of camaraderie from the revolutionary era. Now the other side was the enemy, to be vanquished. During the war, some women had become avid patriots after watching British troops plunder their homes. Anna Caldwell, of the renowned Ogden family in Newark and a mother of nine, resisted British attempts to burn her home and was shot. Now, amid what Rosemary Zaghari has dubbed a revolutionary backlash, they became easy scapegoats whenever outcomes differed from predictions. In the early years, especially after the contentious 1800 election in which Thomas Jefferson finally bested Aaron Burr in the House of Representatives, men on both sides credited women. In Stony Hill, they raised their glasses to the fair daughters of Columbia, those who voted in behalf of Jefferson and Burr in particular. In Bloomfield, they toasted the Republican Fair, adding, "May their patriotic conduct and the late elections add an irresistible zest to their charms." In Mendham, too, they prayed that the female Republican conduct be pleasing and exemplary to their sisters of the Union. But in fact, both Federalists and Democratic Republicans suspected women of aiding the opposing party, of voting wrong. In 1802, Republicans complained when Federalists gained an equal number of representatives in the state legislature. They blamed illegal voting by a married woman and a black slave, tilting results toward Federalists in Hunterdon County. A legislative investigation found, indeed, that the married woman had been separated from her husband and paid taxes under her maiden name, a subversion of the laws. The inquiry also found that an African-American woman suspected of being a slave had actually purchased her freedom from her owner. It remains unclear if either woman voted illegally, or if they had, whether it changed the election results. What is clear is that male partisans on all sides felt free to disparage them. Patriarchy held voting women as an abomination, a disorderly blight on public life. They were expendable, easy scapegoats in a political fight, which is exactly how they lost the vote. Thomas Jefferson had once said that American women, unlike their French counterparts, should be too wise to wrinkle their foreheads with politics and should instead be contented to soothe and calm the minds of their husbands returning ruffled from political debate. Now his Republicans, also angry that Federalist women had cast a sizable 150 votes for Jonathan Drayton in a Senate race, grew nostalgic for an earlier generation, when women were characterized by chastity, prudence, and industry. Critics disparaged the female voter and her insertion of petticoat politics, hardly the Republican motherhood founders envisioned. In a 1798 commentary, Griffith described female voting as a mockery. One writer to the Republican newspaper, True American, expressed alarm at a defect in our Constitution, allowing whole wagon loads of those privileged fair to show up at the polls. "In some townships, I am told they made up almost a fourth of the total votes," he despaired, signing his letter, "Friend to the Ladies." Calls grew to reclaim male privilege. In 1803, one observer claimed that women in Newark had vied with men, and in some instances eclipsed them in stuffing the ballot box. Now they were said to be corrupt, too easily swayed, not fit for the vote. By the turn of the century, there was a sharpening of the gender borders. In 1804, with Jefferson seeking re-election, Republicans in the state offered an act for the gradual abolition of slavery. In one of the party newspapers, the Newark Sentinel of Freedom, editors referred to blacks as gentlemen, published letters from politicians of color, and authored poems with implicit messages of outreach. "Though black his skin as shades of night, his heart is fair, his soul is white." 2 years later, liberal Republicans in the state began agitating to extend the vote, saying, "A widow's mite is property, but so is the life of any male, black, white, red, or yellow citizen." In a nation where, as John Adams said, "power always follows property," this return to gender preference must have been soothing to men outraged by the advent of female voting. 3 years later, the state's 30-year experiment of extending the vote to women came to an end. The precipitating incident was a dispute in Essex County over where to put a new courthouse. Moderate Republicans favored Elizabethtown. Liberal Republicans insisted on Newark. After Newark won, moderates protested that the election had been fraudulent, with allegations of ballot stuffing. For years, there had been talk about illegal voting by wives and daughters who lived under the roof of their husbands and fathers, and by black men who were not worth 50 pounds. Now, critics saw an opening. Petitioning for annulment of the constitutional provision, they demanded that election laws be changed. Leading the fight was John Condict, a Republican congressman who believed he had nearly been defeated at the last election by the votes of 75 female Federalists. "Whereas," began his bill, doubts have been raised and great diversities in practice obtained throughout the state in regard to the admission of aliens, females, and persons of color, or Negroes, to vote in elections. And whereas it is highly necessary to the safety, quiet, good order, and dignity of the state to clear up the said doubts. New Jersey would reassert the interests of the state and return to an electorate of free white men. Newark got its courthouse. Elizabethtown got a new election law limiting the vote to white, male, taxpaying citizens over 21. And Condict won his revenge through this legislative compromise. No matter the rationale, the legislature saw and welcomed the opportunity to reclaim the quiet, good order, and dignity of our states. After 31 years of voting, after being courted by political parties and wooed by candidates, women were disenfranchised to give the Democratic Republic Party advantage in the 1808 presidential election. Not surprisingly, the new party's candidate, James Madison, won decisively. That female protests were muted says much about the political climate. As quickly as it came, political equality for women in New Jersey disappeared, as if it were a ghost standing on the shoulders of political whim, in the service of political interests. As the New Jersey case demonstrated, the Federalists were losing power. And after the War of 1812, the party faded into oblivion. The birth of partisan parties led to toxic campaigns, mudslinging, and a new kind of ungentlemanly politics. Republicans in the 13 original colonies and in the 11 new ones who sought admission to the Union before 1830 now sought to change the shape and the color of the electorate. Because states controlled who voted, they drafted new constitutions redefining voting qualifications, in some cases granting the vote to white men without property, an idea that had been an anathema to Federalists. By the 1830s, seeking to eliminate a monopoly of government by elites, Andrew Jackson enfranchised white men without property, disenfranchised black men, and removed from the rolls Cherokee men who served those in power. Thus, he expanded the electorate, seeking universal white male suffrage without tax requirements, making it whiter, poorer, less diverse. For their part, Republicans deliberately excluded women and blacks. The case of Anna Gordon Martin further cemented this turn against women. In 1805, the Supreme Judicial Court of Massachusetts had considered the case of her son, who was trying to reclaim the land his mother had left behind when she and his father, loyalist to the crown, fled Massachusetts during the war. She had brought significant real estate holdings to the marriage. The court ruled that she had not been free to remain in Massachusetts to proclaim herself a patriot. She was married with no free will, either as a property owner or as a political actor. The revolutionary rhetoric of the late 18th century now gave way to a new pragmatism in the early 19th century. As historian Linda Kerber noted, restricting women's politicization was one of a series of conservative choices that Americans made in the post-war years as they avoided the full implication of their own revolutionary radicalism. As Virginia was redrafting its state constitution in 1829, one woman wrote to the Richmond Inquirer to protest. "Why is it that the pretensions of almost every other class of society have been duly weighed?" wrote the woman, "yet one half of the society was still cut off at one throw from all share in the administration of government." This missive by a reader, who signed herself as a Virginia free woman, was an early indication that women began agitating for the vote long before the 1848 Women's Rights Convention in Seneca Falls, New York. Even at this early stage in the nation's evolution, they were asking to participate in the affairs of governance. Amid a trend in the states to ignore women's rights and instead grant manhood to white men, no matter their wealth or holdings, many women, white and black, turned to knocking down barriers, not to the ballot, but to the schoolroom door. Pursuing education. For Jefferson, a new nation required a systematic procedure of educating the boys to instruct the mass of our citizens in these their rights, interests, and duties as men and citizens. Until then, women had been taught to read, but not to write. Now, Benjamin Rush, a prominent Philadelphia physician and signer of the Declaration of Independence, spoke up for women. In his 1787 Thoughts Upon Female Education, he argued, a principal share of the instruction of children naturally devolves upon the women. It becomes us, therefore, to prepare them, by a suitable education, for the discharge of this important duty of mothers. It was up to the ladies, he noted, to concur in instructing their sons in the principles of liberty and government. But Rush also saw practical needs for educating women, suggesting they be schooled in the more useful branches of literature, trained to be stewards and guardians of their husband's property, and to manage a household staff. He advocated teaching them to read English properly, write legibly, and keep figures and bookkeeping, so that a wife could serve as executrix of an estate if her husband predeceased her. He also sought to counter what he saw as women's tendency towards superstition, suggesting rounding out female education with study of geography and history, even astronomy and natural philosophy, all to make her an agreeable companion for the sensible man. Many women rallied to the call for more equality in education, and some hailed their new role in educating the new generation. As Abigail Adams had written to her husband in 1776, if we mean to have heroes, statesmen, and philosophers, we should have learned women. But if Republican motherhood was the public rationale for educating women, it was not one they all shared. In 1793, Priscilla Mason graduated from Young Ladies Academy in Philadelphia, taking the podium as class valedictorian. Celebrating the victory of women over ignorance, she castigated men for seizing power. Our high and mighty lords, thanks to their arbitrary constitutions, have denied us the means of knowledge, and then reproached us for the want of it. Lamenting that man, despotic man, had closed to women the doors to the church, the bar, and the senate, she spoke of the sources of knowledge gradually opening to our sex. She urged women to overcome male opposition and take for themselves the schooling that was their due. That same year, Catherine Ferguson, a former slave who had purchased her freedom from her owner, began a school for the poor in New York, open to black and white children. In 1802, Judith Sargent Murray, a prominent political essayist who had overseen the education of 12 children, including her daughter, helped open a school for girls in Dorchester, Massachusetts, with her cousins Judith Foster Saunders and Clementina Beach. The oldest of eight children, Murray had taught herself history, philosophy, geography, and literature in the family's vast library. During the Revolution, she had written widely on the need for female education and the right of women to control their earnings. One year before Wollstonecraft's Vindication of the Rights of Woman, Murray penned On the Equality of the Sexes. Under a male pseudonym, she wrote columns in the local newspapers. In the school's first advertisement, which Murray wrote, the two educators promised to teach reading, English, grammar, writing, arithmetic, the French language, geography, including the use of globes, needlework in all its branches, painting, and hair work upon ivory. Over the next years, a number of female academies would spring up, including Mrs. Rowson's Academy, a boarding school in downtown Boston, opened by Susan Rowson, a novelist and actress who shared Murray's views that the human mind, whether possessed by man or woman, is capable of the highest refinement and most brilliant acquirements. Hundreds and later thousands attended, entering the public domain as educators, writers, and reform-minded leaders of benevolent societies. Harriet Beecher Stowe, born in 1811, later author of Uncle Tom's Cabin, was schooled at Lichfield Academy, learning there the Western canon of literature that no doubt helped her write the best-selling novel of the 19th century. By the 1800s, other institutions of greater academic ambition opened their doors to women. Emma Hart Willard established the Troy Female Seminary in 1821. The first school to offer women a broad-based and rigorous education comparable to that taught at all male academies. No longer limited to courses in French conversation and embroidery, 90 women attended the first lectures in mathematics, science, history, foreign language, and literature. Chemist Mary Lyon founded Mount Holyoke Female Seminary in 1837 with the slogan, "Go where no one else goes. Do what no one else will do." The first of the so-called Seven Sisters colleges of Ivy League reputation, the school prided itself on low tuition and rigorous entrance exams. On opening day in 1837, Lyon proclaimed a new era in female education. It is hard to overestimate the revolutionary nature of this new era of female education. By one estimate, nearly 200 female academies and seminaries opened in the North and South between 1790 and 1820, a number that nearly doubled by the Civil War. Few of these institutions, no more than 15 by one count, were open to African Americans, and a little over half of these to Black women. Prudence Crandall, a white Quaker woman, defied racial boundaries in her small Connecticut town when, in 1833, she invited a young African American student, Sarah Harris, to enroll at her Canterbury Female Seminary. When white students fled, Crandall turned her seminary into an all-Black institution, the High School for Young Colored Ladies and Misses. The town's reaction, led by Andrew Judson, a state attorney, politician, and fervent believer that free Blacks should be recolonized in Africa, laid bare its racist prejudices. White residents, fearful that New England might become the Liberia of America, a site of Black empowerment, poured manure into the school's water well, set its building on fire, and refused services, from groceries to medical care, to its staff and students. Rather than being hailed for extending educational opportunities to free Black women, for teaching Christian principles and ethics to girls from 8 to 20, Crandall was prosecuted for violating a local law, the so-called Black Law, which banned teaching of out-of-state African-American students. She spent a brief time in jail before her conviction was overturned. Later, her students wrote about their trial and struggles in earning an education. One student delivered an address saying she and her sister students had begun to enjoy what our minds have long desired, viz., the advantages of a good education. Another urged residents of Canterbury to obey the voice of duty and emulate Crandall, who stepped from within the shadow of prejudice to plead their cause, in the midst of persecution, with great success. Another asked simply, "Where is justice?" Amid the violence, the school closed its doors in 1834. All of the players in the Canterbury saga, the prosecutors, the defense attorneys, the trial judges, and the appellate court judges, were men. Crandall was barred from either attending or speaking at a town meeting called to discuss the case because of her gender. In his appeals to the court, Judson could not have made it clearer that the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.